Pass me not, oh gentle Savior.
All right, let's get going.
Hear my humble cry while on others thou art calling. Do not pass.
How's everyone? Great. Hey, can you turn me down just a little bit, Leland? Thank you, brother. Awesome. All right. A few things going on. You guys get involved in some of this stuff. Men's prayers this Saturday. If you haven't signed up for that, please let me know tonight if you're going to plan to come to that and you haven't already filled out a Connect card or responded to my email for that. Need to make sure we got the food countdown. So it's this Saturday at 8 o'clock. So talk to me after service if you're planning to come to that. Also this weekend is Brandy Robinson's shower. If you haven't signed up for that, I think there's a sign up out at the Connect desk. Make sure you stop out there and sign up for that. That's going to be right after service on Sunday, pretty much right after service. We've got the Memorial Day picnic coming up, Memorial Day weekend, the 29th. We're going to have that right after service. Stick around and just have a burger and a dog and play some games with us. We'll just relax and have a good time. Sign up if you're coming, though. Again, for food purposes, we'd like to have a head count, and you can sign up to bring a side or a dessert or both, whatever the Lord would lead you to do. We've got some games planned for that day. We'll just have a good time out there. Weather permitting, we'll be out there. Bring your own chair. If you got maybe a canopy tent you want to bring, don't mind setting it up. We could do that too. We'll take care of the church. Will take care of the main dish, the burgers and dogs, and supply some water. But make sure you just stick around. Invite somebody to come with you too. It's just we haven't been able to do this for a couple of years, so I'm glad we're able to have a Memorial Day picnic again and just spend some time together. VBS is coming up real quick. So as we've been encouraging people to get involved in that, please do so. We're looking for folks that can help us with the decorations. We've been having great turnouts on Monday nights, getting ready for that. So I've been thrilled with that. We've been getting a lot done. Join us any Monday at 6:30 right here at church. We're putting together some of the decorations. If I can do it, you can do it. You don't need any special abilities, believe me. To be a help for that. So if you can make it out on a Monday, that's awesome. Also, get involved and volunteer that week, June 13th. It's a little less than a month away. So June 13th to the 17th is going to be the week of VBS. Amanda told me only got 6 kids signed up so far. So those of you that have kids that are coming, please sign up as quickly as you can so we can get some numbers in there involved. And then we've got these little cards that we've printed up. Take some of these are out at the Connect desk. Take one of these, you can hand these out. It's just got all the information about the VBS. There's a little QR code on there. All they got to do is scan that with their phone, and then they can register their child right there online through the website. So take some of these and hand these out. Throw these in the door hangers and stuff. So we'll get as much of this out in the community as we can. And so please take advantage of that. We've got that week, we'll need help in a number of areas. Craft help. Carrie's running the crafts, but she'll need hands and bodies to help corral kids with paint and glue. You can imagine what that'll be like. With the games, we'll have the games. We'll have we'll need team leaders. Some of the adults would love to see you guys be a team leader for a group of kids. Get down on their level, be there with them, pray with them. Just love on them that night, those nights of the VBS. So there's a volunteer meeting this Sunday after service. I think it's going to be in the teen room, if I'm not mistaken. We'll announce that Sunday. But if you're interested in finding out more about volunteering, make sure you attend that meeting this Sunday if you can. Also this summer, we've got our summer Bible club. They're calling it Bible Circus. And so if you've got a child, an elementary school age child that wants to be part of Bible club this summer, make sure you get them registered. It's going to start June 8th, so just a few weeks away, June 8th. And so they've got some cool stuff planned for those summer months for them. Same deal, QR code you can scan and you can get them registered online. So do that as well. I mentioned a few weeks ago that we're going to be doing something a little different this summer with Wednesday nights. We're going to be doing a Bible project this summer. We're going to take the summer months and be putting together New Testaments that are going to eventually make their way into the Philippines. And so we'll start at 6:30 with maybe a short time of prayer and devotion, and then we'll start the assembly project until, 8:15 or whatever. And so that's going to start the 8th of June. So obviously study tonight. Next week is Awana Awards. So come and celebrate with the kids. June 1st, no study, no Awana, no teen ministry, just a collective, let's take a deep breath week as a church. And then June 8th, Summer Bible Club will kick off and the Summer Bible Assembly Project will kick off. All right, so we've got some cool stuff coming down the pipe this summer. I encourage you to get involved and bring your energy and your great attitude and all your gifts and abilities, and let's get after it this summer, serving the Lord and watching Him change some lives, especially some lives of some young people as we pour our lives into them. So let's pray, and we'll get into the study tonight. Let's pray. Father, we love You. We thank You for Christ. We are appreciative to be here tonight. Lord, we love You so much, and we can't thank You enough for all that You do for us. Father, You bless us abundantly. And so we come this evening just thanking You and praising You. Lord, we lift up the Awana ministry to You. We know it's coming down to the final weeks. We pray Your blessing upon them tonight and next week as they do their awards. Lord, we also lift up the Vacation Bible School. We lift up the Summer Bible Club, and we pray that those two things could bring honor and glory to You, and that You would use those things in the lives of young people who maybe need to know You as Savior or want to grow in their walk with You. Father, pour Your Spirit out upon these things. Lord, we also pray for the Bible Project this summer, and that You would please bless that time and use these scriptures, Father, to make a difference around the world. Lord, we love You and lift this all up to You in the name of Christ. Amen. All right, if you have your Bible, go ahead and be turning to Deuteronomy 17. I've told you that these 3 weeks that we have between finishing our last study and then the summertime, I was just going to share a few things with you that God was showing me out of the book of Deuteronomy. And so we're going to be in Deuteronomy chapter 17 tonight. I mentioned just a moment ago the Bible project we're going to be doing this summer. And those of you that have been around a while, you know that that's a ministry that's near and dear to the heart of our church. We try and pour resources and manpower into Scripture and Scripture Assembly. We try and financially help with different Bible projects that other organizations or churches are doing because we think it's important to get the Word of God into the hands of men and women around the world. We think that is one of our responsibilities as the New Testament church, to be involved in that. And why do we view it as being important? Well, because we hold the Word of God in high esteem. We view God's Word as probably the most valuable of resources that you have as a believer in Christ. And saying it that way may even be understating it. Your relationship with God's Word is paramount in your walk with Christ. If you don't have a relationship with the Word of God, then your relationship with Christ is probably struggling. If you aren't having quality time with the Lord in His Word on a consistent basis, then your walk is not going to be consistent. There's no way to sugarcoat it. There's really no way around that. That's just the reality of it. And we all have ebbs and flows in our walk. We all have good days and bad days, if you will, in terms of our interaction with God's Word. Sometimes it's like drinking out of a fire hose. Other days it's like trying to squeeze a drop out of a cactus in the Sahara Desert. to get something from the Word of God. Hopefully we find ourselves more towards the fire hose end more often. But if you're at least not turning on the spigot and trying to get something out of it, then you're going to struggle. You just are. Even if you are consistently in the Word of God and hearing from Him on a regular basis, the battle is still fierce in our Christian walk, and we're still prone to wander, even if we're plugged in and abiding, as we've been talking a lot about in Christ. And so that's why we feel like our investment in Scripture, and in particular getting Scripture into the hands of men and women, other believers around the world, is so important. Many places in the world, they don't enjoy the luxury of having the printed copy of the Word of God like you and I do. We have been blessed in that regard, and so we want to make sure that we're doing our part to help people in that respect. In Deuteronomy chapter 17, right at the end of this chapter, it says something that at least to me is incredibly interesting. We're going to see here as we read this in just a moment in verses 18 through 20, that one of the responsibilities that a new king in Israel had was he was to sit down and handwrite a copy of the commandments of God for his own personal use. So think about that for a second. He was to, I don't know that he would copy the whole thing. Based on the language in Deuteronomy chapter 17, it could be that he just had to rewrite the book of Deuteronomy. But let's say it went even beyond that. Maybe he had to write Leviticus and portions of Exodus and portions of Deuteronomy out by hand. He couldn't go to a bookstore. He couldn't go on Amazon.com and get the latest version for his Kindle or his iPad. He sat and wrote out longhand the commandments of God, which is fascinating to me. I mentioned this in a sermon a few months ago, and I was in Milford, Ohio, at Bearing Precious Seed. You may not, if you don't know that name, Bearing Precious Seed is the ministry that supplies a lot of the manuscripts that we order and assemble here and collate at our church. They have huge printing presses. They print the Word of God. They ship it all over the country and all over the world. And as I was taking the tour, Al Braley, who is the director of Bearing Precious Seed, took me in his office, and on his bookshelf was several volumes, probably 6 to 8 volumes, yay thick and big books, you know, 12-inch books, where their church had literally taken upon themselves to handwrite out the Word of God. As a church, they sat down, they started in Genesis 1, and they had people take shifts, and they just started in the beginning, God created. And so they wrote out the Word of God by hand on the basis of their pastor at the time, Dr. Keene's statement, if we have to write it by hand, we're publishing the Word of God. And so they did. They made copies of God's Word, and so you open it, and it's got all this different styles of handwriting where people have taken their section and wrote it out. And I thought, wow, that's incredible. That's so awesome. Well, that's what the king had to do. He had to sit down, and he had to handwrite out the law of the Lord. Now, let's read this together. Look at verse 18, Deuteronomy 17, 18. It says, "And it shall be, when he sitteth upon the throne of his kingdom, that he shall write him a copy of this law in a book out of that which is before the priests and the Levites. And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God, to keep all the commandments of the law, and these statutes to do them, that his heart be not lifted up above his brethren, and that he turn not aside from the commandment to the right hand or to the left, to the end that he may prolong his days in his kingdom, he and his children in the midst of Israel." And so here in this short little passage of Scripture, I think the Lord gives us multiple reasons as to why he's given us the Word of God. And we see it here as it pertains to reasons for why he wanted the king of Israel to have his own copy of God's Word. And I think it's so interesting before we even get into the reasons that he's given us the word of God. So it says here, he says in verse 17, that he shall write him a copy of this law in a book out of that which is before the priests and the Levites. And so he would, the manuscripts of the law would be with the priests. They were charged with keeping that. And he would go and he would sit and he would look at that and he would handwrite it out. And then notice that it says in 19, and it shall be with him. He took it. He wrote it. They put it in a book, and he kept that book with him. It was his. It was his. Before we even get into the reasons, do you have a book that's yours? That's yours. I'm not talking about grabbing one of the pew Bibles out of the back, although they're fine. I'm talking about a book that's yours. One that nobody else gets to use. No one else. It's got your notes in it. It's got things God has shown you in it. You know where things are on the page in it because you've spent time in it. I don't know how many times I've done that in my life where I thought, man, what was that verse? I know it's right in the upper right-hand corner. And I just start flipping pages. Oh, there it is. You know, I'll eventually find it. Do you have a copy of God's word that's yours? Now, I don't know where everybody is in their walk with the Lord. Maybe you haven't known the Lord that much. Maybe you haven't spent a lot of time in the Word of God. Obviously, I would encourage you to do that. But as you do, I think what happens over time is your Bible, it becomes more yours. It's not just a Bible. It's your Bible. And, you know, it's filled with your marks and your coffee spills and maybe marks from your tears that fall on the page. And so I just think it's interesting that he kept that book with him. He didn't leave it at church, you know, church for the Jew. He didn't leave it in the sanctuary. He took it. He had it. It was his, okay? And so why was he to do this? What were the reasons that God wanted him to have that? Well, the first one is there in verse 19. And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life. So the first reason is reading. Reading. The king was to develop a lifelong habit of reading the commandments of the Lord. He was to spend time with them. He was to read them all the days of his life. And the same is true for us. Again, I know this is a drum that we pound regularly here at Grace, but we'll continue to pound it. And that is that you need to have that daily interaction and communion with God in His Word, especially during those times when you think, I don't have time to do it this morning, or I don't feel like doing it this morning. That's mostly when we need it worst, is when I need to just get in there. And I can't tell you how many times I've dove into the Word of God and started to read, and you know how it is. The mind is doing this. It's all over the place. I'm not connecting. Nothing's going in. Beow, beow, beow. You know, it's just ricocheting off me, and I'm not really getting a lot out of it. But then I just keep going. I keep plowing. I keep searching and seeking, and then all of a sudden, it's just like everything kind of fades away, and you start to tune in to what God is saying. Sometimes it takes a little time to get the world out of us so that God can speak to us, to get that flesh crucified so that the Spirit can teach and instruct. But we need to be reading God's Word. You say, Brad, I'm not a reader. I wasn't really either. I got saved when I was in college. The last thing I wanted was something else to read. I had enough reading to do. But I made a commitment to get in and read God's Word. This isn't like reading the latest New York Times bestseller. This is God's Word to you. This is God's thoughts preserved for you. And so it's not like reading the paper or reading a novel or even reading a technical book or something for work. It's God's Word to us. We looked at this verse Sunday night as I was talking with Ty, our high school graduate, In 1 Timothy 4:13, Paul, talking to Timothy, his disciple, says, "Till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine." So one of the things that Paul tells his young protege, his young disciple, is you need to pay attention. You need to give heed to, give attendance to reading God's Word. Again, he's not talking about reading the paper. He's talking about reading the Word of God. It's an important part. You know, there was a time in church where a sizable portion of the church service was committed to reading aloud portions of God's Word. And the reason that that practice was in place was because it really wasn't all that long ago in the grand scheme of things that not everyone had a copy of God's Word. They didn't have multiple copies of the Bible laying around. They couldn't open their tablet or get on their phone and go to the YouVersion app and pull up the Bible that they wanted to read. And so they would come and they would listen to God's Word being read, and that was the only interaction that they would have hearing God's Word all week long. Now think about that. I was just thinking about that thought today. I mean, sadly, sometimes that's still the only interaction that God's people have with the Word of God, is what they hear on a Sunday morning. I mean, if you think about like music, I love music, and I listen to music a lot. If I'm at the gym, I got my headphones on. If I'm mowing, I'm either listening to a sermon or some kind of music I just love music. But I think about people like back in the day before recording equipment or remember those things, records or radio stations or phonographs or something. Am I getting all of you now? Before any of that, if you wanted to hear music, you had to go and listen to a live performance, especially if you couldn't play an instrument. And that was the only interaction that you got with music. You couldn't put your headphones on. You couldn't turn the car radio on. That was you wanted to hear music? You had to go to a concert and listen to it played live. Same is true with the Word of God. People came to church. They wanted to hear what God had to say. God spoke to them as it was read. That's not a practice that's, even if it is practiced in churches today, it's usually smaller portion. You read some of those things back in the Old Testament, and they would stand there all day long while somebody stood up at a pulpit and read God's Word. Can you imagine the revolt I would have on my hands if we showed up at 10 and I said, "Stand up, and we're not leaving until evening service is over tonight, and I'm just going to stand here and read." I'd have a fit, probably. But that's the way it was. But it's important because it's for our spiritual nourishment. We need that interaction with God's Word because it's how God feeds us. And when we're reading God's Word, He is nourishing us through that interaction with God's Word. Job 23:12, I think it is. I don't think I put that in your notes. I think it's 23:12, where Job says, "I have esteemed the words of His mouth more than my necessary food." So Job held the Word of God in higher regard than eating physically. It was more important to him. I came across this story in a book some time ago about a Christian Vietnamese man. His name was Hien Pham, P-H-A-M. And Mr. Pham, he was, as I said, a Christian Vietnamese who spoke English and was an interpreter for the American troops in Vietnam during the Vietnam War. And so after that war ended and the communists came into the country, he was thrown into prison because of his allegiance to the United States and the forces fighting against communism. And so he was in prison for some time. You can imagine what that would have been like in Vietnam, being in prison. And so he's there, been there for some time, months and months and months, if not years. One day he was selected to do the job that nobody else in the entire compound wanted to do. He was assigned latrine duty. So he was given the job of cleaning out the latrine, which was basically, a plank of wood with some holes cut in it with some buckets underneath each hole. That was the latrine. And I don't mean to be too gross, but I think it enhances the story, at least makes us appreciate it. And so he would take the bucket that was filled with all types of disgusting things, and as he's dumping out the bucket, he noticed some paper in one of the buckets that had English on it. And he hadn't seen English in a while. He'd been in there a long time, and they certainly weren't letting them read English. But it caught his eye, didn't know what it was, but he took it out of the bucket, washed it off the best he could, and stuck it in his pocket. And so later that night, when he was back in his room and all of his cellmates had gone to bed, he pulled out a small light that he had, and he looked at the piece of paper, and it was Romans chapter 8 out of the Bible. And he hadn't seen the Bible in, again, years probably. Certainly not an English Bible. And if you don't know what, in Romans chapter 8 is a great chapter that talks about how all things, right, work together for good to them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose. That verse is in there. The verse, what shall separate us from the love of God? That passage is in there. It talks about the Spirit of God and the power that we have in the Spirit. And so he's reading Romans chapter 8 and just being blessed and encouraged by the Word of God. Just at that moment when he was about to quit, God supplied his Word for him. And so he started to volunteer every day to clean the latrine, just in hopes of finding more portions of God's Word. And he did. One of the officers or soldiers in the compound was using it as toilet paper. And so every day he's cleaning the latrines, pulling out portions of God's Word, washing it off, saving it, and compiling it, taking it, and reading it, and being encouraged and blessed. I thought, wow. Is that the attitude we have toward God's Word? You see, I mean, it for us, you know, we have so much access to the Bible. Multiple copies, most of us. We have it on our phone, on our tablets, on our computers. We can listen to it if we want to. We can read it. We can have somebody read it to us. I've got an app on my phone. I don't even have to read it. I can have James Earl Jones read it to me if I want to. It's nothing like having Darth Vader read you the Bible. But is it precious to us? Do we long for it so much that we'd be willing to dig through waste just to have a little piece of it? You see, God gave his Word to us, and men and women throughout the ages have paid very high prices, many with their own lives, so that you and I could sit here tonight and have a copy of God's Word that we can read. I don't want us to take that for granted. Not only that, I want us to have a heart of gratitude and appreciation for the Word of God and the price that was paid. But beyond that, I want us simply to understand God wants to speak to you. God's preparing a meal for you. God wants to fellowship with you. He wants to instruct you and encourage you and convict you if you need that. All of that begins in reading the Word of God. So that's one of the reasons he gave us the Word, is to read it. Let's look at the next thing. It says, and it shall be with him, and he shall read therein. I'm on verse 19 again, 17, 19. He shall read therein all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God. So the next reason is learning. Learning. Our society is really obsessed with education, and I'm not necessarily saying that that's entirely bad. Most of you know my wife's a teacher, and so I have a fond spot in my heart for educators. They're the best. And I remember when we were on the East Coast in New Jersey, my wife, Carrie, taught in a private school. It wasn't a Christian school, but it was a private school, and it was a K through 8th grade school, and at the time, and this is a while back, it cost over $20,000 a year for elementary school, for people to send their kids to this school. And so you can imagine if a family is investing that type of funds into an education, they want their money's worth, so to speak. And so very much about, okay, K through 8, what does my child have to do to get to the next level when they go to the best high school, which then in turn will help them to get into the best Ivy League school? And so it was about getting to that next level. And Carrie saw some incredible things in terms of parents' behavior over children who got B's instead of A's. And you can imagine, and that was just such emphasis placed on that. And again, that's not all bad. I think education is a good thing, but I think we tend to view it as the solution to all of our societal woes, and I don't think that that's obviously the case. But he says here, this is a different kind of learning, isn't it? It's not book smarts. It's not, hey, you need to learn math or reading or sciences and those types of things. What does he say he wants them to learn? Fear the Lord. Fear the Lord. That you may learn to fear the Lord his God. And so one of the reasons that he's given us his word is as we're reading it, we're learning about the Lord, and that is causing us to fear him. That's the outcome that God's looking for from our interaction with the word of God, is that we would fear the Lord more and more. I would just say to you, generally speaking, that not too many people fear God today. And I'm not just talking about lost people, I'm talking about Christian people. And there needs to be a reverential awe and fear of the Lord. We need that, but it doesn't come naturally. A couple of verses, Romans chapter 3 and verse 18. If you're ever feeling too good about yourself, just go read Romans chapter 3. It'll put you back in your place very quickly. It says things like, there is none good, no, not one. It says here in verse 18, there is no fear of God before their eyes. And so it's not a natural thing for us to fear God, but I think it is a learned attitude that we can have in our life as we spend time in God's word. And I think it's that fear of God that helps us to clean up our own lives and stay right with the Lord. Look in 2 Corinthians 7 and verse 1. 2 Corinthians 7 and verse 1. It says, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. And so if I know God and I have a healthy fear of God, it's that fear that keeps me on the straight and narrow. It helps me cleanse myself from those, as he calls it here, the filthiness of the flesh and spirit, and move toward a complete holiness in my life. If I don't have God's fear, I'll never have that. So how do we get that? All right, let's look in Proverbs chapter 2. Proverbs chapter 2. Look at verse 1. It says, "My son, if thou wilt receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart to understanding, yea, if thou criest after knowledge and liftest up thy voice for understanding, if thou seekest her," wisdom is what he's the "her there, as silver, and searchest for her as for hid treasures, then thou shalt understand," what? "The fear of the Lord, and find the knowledge of God." And so that whole passage that we just read is a big if-then statement. If you're any of you guys are computer-type folks, you know that things are based in if-then. If this happens, then that happens. And he's saying, if you do this, if you seek it this way, if you have this attitude, if, then, if you do that, then you're going to understand the fear of the Lord. But I want you to look at verse 4 in particular. "If thou seekest her as silver, and searches for her as for hid treasures." I think that all those verses are great, and I don't want to deal with every single one of them, but I do want to just quickly touch on that mentality of how we go after the Word of God, how we seek after it. He says, if you do it like man seeks wealth, silver and gold, then you're going to find it. If we have the same diligence, persistence, desire, drive that we do to accumulate wealth, then we're gonna be able to understand the fear of God. I've already alluded to the fact that we lived on the East Coast, and we lived in Princeton, New Jersey, which is pretty much smack dab middle in the middle of New Jersey. It's about equidistant between New York City and Philadelphia, about 50 miles from each. And in Princeton, there was a little bitty place called Princeton Junction, which is basically a train station. And so if you were commuting into the city, you could drive if you were crazy. If you were really wealthy, you could take a helicopter, which was not an uncommon occurrence. But the common, average, everyday person, most of them rode the train. And so you had about an hour train ride just to get to Penn Station in New York City. And then most likely you had to take a subway for some time to get wherever else in the city, downtown, uptown, wherever you were going from there. And so you had a minimum of probably an hour and a half to 2 hour commute one way every day just to get to your job. And then that night you did it in reverse all the way back home. And you probably didn't leave the office at 5. In fact, it wasn't an uncommon complaint I would hear from workers on the East Coast, because they knew I was from the Midwest, to go, "What? Where? How come nobody out there works after 5 o'clock?" It was a pretty frequent comment that I would hear. So, but why am I bringing that up? I'm bringing it up because I was continually amazed at the amount of energy and effort and drive that people would display. Why? Because they loved their jobs. No, because they were getting paid a whole bunch of money. The amount of money that flows around out there in that place staggered me when I moved out there. Crazy. And everybody's chasing it. And they're willing to sacrifice time with their kids and with their spouse, and they're in many cases willing to sacrifice their own health and up early and to bed late, and the list goes on and on and on. If we could take that same type of commitment and bring that mentality with us when we come to the Word of God and begin to seek after God and His Word with that same diligence, I think God would speak to us in unbelievable ways, and we would come to understand what it means to fear the Lord. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 13. Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived outside of Christ, after pursuing all the worldly pleasures, all the things that the world says we need to go after in order to make us happy, wealth, material possessions, relationships, just, you name it. the guy went after it. That's what, in fact, that's what the book of Ecclesiastes is about. It's his a record of his pursuit of fulfillment and happiness in life through every means possible. And at the end of it all, he says in 13, Ecclesiastes 12, 13, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. What is this conclusion? Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. Fear God and keep his commandments. And so we as believers in Christ need to come to the Word of God, reading it, and through reading it, learning about the Lord, and as a result of learning about the Lord, we learn to fear the Lord. And that, in turn, changes the way we live. And so we read it, we learn from it. What's the next one? Let's go back to Deuteronomy chapter 17 again. Deuteronomy chapter 17. Let's read 17, 19. And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life, and that he may learn to fear the Lord his God, to keep all his words of this law. To keep. It's another reason he's given it to us is for keeping. Keeping. Now, when we read that word keep or keeping in Scripture and we think about it, I think sometimes we read it with the idea of doing, right? To keep it is to do it. Well, we're going to see that they're two separate things because that's the next one on our outline is doing. So what is this keeping thing? Well, the word keep here means to watch over, to guard, or to preserve. So one of the responsibilities of the king was to watch over, guard, or preserve, to keep the words of God. Think of it this way. How many of you have ever been to a soccer game? A few of you. You've all at least seen a soccer game, yes? How about hockey? Okay. If you haven't been to a soccer game, you've been to a hockey game. Well, on a soccer team or on a hockey team, one of the positions that a person plays is what's called the goal keeper. What is their responsibility? It is to keep the ball or puck out of their net. They're guarding that net. They're keeping everything, at least they're trying to keep everything out of it. They're protecting it. They're guarding it. And so I want you to think of the word keeping in that sense. It's to guard or to protect or to watch over or to preserve. And so the king, and I think along with the Levitical priest, were charged with the responsibility of keeping the words of God, preserving the word of God, watching over them, guarding them, treasuring them, preserving them for future generations. And notice that it says, look at verse 19 again, and it says, to keep how many, some of the words? Many of the words? No, all the words. Again, we don't have time to go into all the painstaking effort that the priest and the king took in order to preserve the words of God from generation to generation. It's mind-boggling, the things that they would do. They did that. They did their best to preserve it. And of course, the Lord's involved in that process too. He promises that he'll preserve it. But I want you to notice it's all the words. A couple of quick verses. Proverbs 30 and verse 5. Proverbs 30 and verse 5. Every word of God is pure. Every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. Add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. Every word of God is pure. Not the ideas, not the concepts. Every word is important. Every word matters. Psalm 12 and verse 6 says, the words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. See that word keep again? So you see, God's involved in the process of keeping the word too, isn't he? But the king was to be concerned with that. The Levitical priesthood was to be concerned with that. And by the way, the church was to be concerned with that also. The church was given the task of keeping the words of God, and they did it so that you and I could have what we have here today. Ladies and gentlemen, that responsibility did not end just because we have a completed translation of the Word of God. It is still our responsibility to be keepers of the Word of God. And that's why we're involved in the Bible ministry the way we are. Because we believe it is incumbent upon us to help other people to have God's Word so that they can read it and learn to fear the Lord. And they can be involved in keeping it. It is our responsibility to do that. Reading it. Learning from it to fear the Lord. Keeping it. And then he also says in verse 19, right at the end of Deuteronomy 17 in verse 19, to do them. To do them. So doing. Doing. Reading, learning, keeping, doing. A relationship with the Word of God never, never, never results in standing still. It always results in movement. It inspires action. The sentence I've put in your notes is one I say often: the application of biblical information results in spiritual transformation. The application, that's the doing part, of biblical information results in spiritual transformation. You want to be changed? You got to become a doer of the Word of God. Not just a knower, a doer. I have to be striving to live out my faith. A couple of verses here. Look in Matthew chapter 7 and verse 24. You'll hear me harp probably till the day I die. It's one of those drums I bang regularly and loudly. That it's not about how much we know, it's about how much we do. It's about how much we live out. It's about the legs that our faith has. It's about applying what we know. Because there's a real danger when we're instructed from the Word of God and we accumulate lots of knowledge. And we'll talk about this in a moment, that we begin to think that we're something that we're not, because we know a lot. Not interested in knowing a lot, I'm interested in doing a lot with what I know. Matthew chapter 7 and verse 24 says, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and, yeah, there it is, and doeth them. So I heard them, but now I'm going to do something with it. Doeth them. I will liken him unto a wise man, which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house upon the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. So Jesus paints a picture with two contrasts, doesn't he? One person has heard the Word of God and is doing the Word of God. They're trying to live it out. The other person has heard the Word of God, but they're not doing the Word of God. The issue wasn't that they didn't have the information they needed, right? That wasn't the issue. They both heard it. But one's chosen to do something, the other has made the decision to do nothing with it. And so they're trying to build something. We might say they're building their life. And the one who heard it and is doing it is founded upon a rock. And they build that house, and then the storms of life come, and they withstand the storms. Why? Because their life is founded upon a rock. Well, what gave them the ability to be founded upon a rock? Hearing the Word and doing the Word. You want to have a strong faith that can withstand the storms of life? Become a doer of the Word, not just a hearer. If you're not leaving here every Wednesday night, every Sunday night, Sunday morning, every opportunity that you have to be instructed, if you're not leaving here with some task that you want to try and live out in your life. It may not be something huge. It may not be something monumental. Maybe it's just a little something that you want to apply in your life. And if you're not walking out of here saying, hey, I'm gonna do this based on what I heard from God's word, then you're just hearing, but you're not doing. We've got to do both, hear it and do it. If we're not doing it, he says, we're going to build that house, but the problem is the foundation isn't good. Storms are going to come regardless, aren't they? But this time, there's no good foundation and the house falls. James 1:22. Let's look at that. James 1:22. This is one of those scary passages to me. James chapter 1 and verse 22. But be ye doers of the word and not hearers only. He doesn't say don't hear. He says just don't hear only. But be ye doers of the word and not hearers. Here's the part that's scary to me. Deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. So the real danger, at least one of the dangers, that we face when we are hearing but not doing the word, is that we deceive ourselves into thinking that we're something that we're not. We deceive ourselves into thinking that we're spiritual when we're not. We deceive ourselves into thinking that we're right with God when we're not. And that's the thing about self-deception, is you don't even realize you're doing it, right? So I think that's the real danger, one of the real dangers of living in a way that I'm not really interested in applying the Word of God or doing the Word of God. Is that I begin to think that I'm good. I'm all right. But we're not. So we need to read it. We need to learn from it. We need to keep it. We need to do it. Verse 20, it says back in Deuteronomy 17 and verse 20, that his heart be not lifted up above his brethren. That his heart be not lifted up above his brethren. Humbling. God has given us the Word of God for our humbling. What would be your response? What do you think your response would be if all of a sudden this room lit up and the glorified Christ was here in our presence in all his majesty and glory? What do you think your response might be if that was the case? Aw, yeah, just an audible gasp. What do you think? You'd probably be on your face, right? You'd fall down at his glory, wouldn't you? He is the living Word. I think if we come to the Word of God with a proper mindset, one of the natural responses is that we end up in that same place of humility in the presence of the written Word of God. It drives us to our knees before Him. It puts us on our face before Him. And because we see Him in the pages of the Word of God. Let's look at a quick story. Look back in 2 Kings chapter 22. 2 Kings chapter 22 and verse 8. This is a story, one of my favorite kings, a guy by the name of Josiah. Josiah is an inspiration. We'll do a message sometime on Josiah. Because he came from a rough background. His dad and his grandfather, they were knuckleheads. They really were. They were some of the most wicked kings that Israel had, and yet Josiah chooses for his example King David. Says he did like his father David did. So he looked back and he found a good godly example. And Josiah was a good king. He began ruling at a young age, very young age, and he's trying to do the right thing. He's trying to get rid of the altars. He's trying to get rid of the Baal worship. He's trying to follow the Lord the best that he can based on what he knows. He's legitimately a good, moral king who's trying the best he can to lead God's people the way God would have him to. And one day he sends one of his subjects down to check on the progress of some remodeling they were doing in the sanctuary. And he comes to find out that they had actually found a copy of the Word of God in the sanctuary. I don't know, maybe it was one of the king's old copies, who knows. But they found a copy of the Word of God. And then in verse 8, let's just look at this. It says, "And Hilkiah the high priest said unto Shaphan the scribe, I have found the book of the law in the house of the Lord. And Hilkiah gave the book to Shaphan, and he read it. And Shaphan the scribe came to the king and brought the king word again and said, Thy servants have gathered the money that was found in the house and have delivered it into the hand of them that do the work." That's the remodeling they were doing. "And have the oversight of the house of the Lord. And Shaphan the scribe showed the king, saying, Hilkiah the priest hath delivered me a book. And Shaphan read it before the king. And it came to pass, when the king had heard the words of the book of the law, that he rent his clothes." That was a sign of grief. Now, get the picture. Josiah is a good, moral, upstanding king, trying to do the best he can to follow God based on what he knows. He's even got a little building project going on in the sanctuary. Wants the place to look nice for God. And then he hears the Word of God, by the way, for the first time ever. He's hearing God's standard. He knows what he's trying to do, but then he hears what God said he should be. And it causes him to grieve, and he rips his clothes. And we won't go because we don't have time to read it on, but then he takes it to another level. But it brings out humility in him because he sees this is God. This is who God is. This is God's expectation, and this is who I am and where I am. And I'm just humbled by that. The Word of God keeps us humble, keeps us from getting lifted up in pride. God reproves us, as according to 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. That's one of the purposes of the Word of God, is to reprove us. Go back to James chapter 1 again. We were just there, but James chapter 1, verses 23 and 25. Verse 23, "For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein," in other words, he's doing it, "he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed." And so one of the things that this book is like, it's like a mirror. He says, a man beholding his face in a natural glass. He's talking about a mirror. When you look into the Word of God through reading it, it's like looking at yourself in a mirror. You know, sometimes I forget what I look like. Sometimes I think, man, Brad Pitt ain't got nothing on me. Or whoever you think's good looking, I don't know. And then I happen across a mirror in my house, and I recognize that that's not true. And even if I'm not holding myself to that ridiculous standard, sometimes in my mind I think I look like I did when I was 25 or 30. And then I look in a mirror and I know that I don't. And see, that's kind of the way we are when it comes to the Word of God. We're going about our business. We think we got it all figured out. And then we open the Word of God. We think we're doing really good. And God goes, no, that's what you really look like. And we're like, oh, yeah. And it humbles us. And that's a good thing. It humbles us. Because in order for God to be exalted, I have to be humbled. He must increase. What'd John say? He must increase, but I must decrease. We need both of those things. All right. Let's look at the next one. Back to Deuteronomy 17. I'm gonna be way long, but oh well. So it says in 20, that his heart be not lifted up above the brethren, his brethren, and that he turn not aside from the commandment to the right hand or to the left. So he's given us the word for guiding. It guides us, keeps us from going to the left or to the right, from turning aside. Carrie's car recently was it was dying. So we ended up getting another vehicle. Not a new car, but new to us car. And it's certainly newer than the one that she had. And her car has this thing, I don't know what it technically is called, but it's like auto correction. Like if you start to drift over the line, the lane assist, thank you. The wheel starts to do this. I hate that. The first time it did that to me, I was like, what in the world is going on here? I said, I don't want a car telling me how I'm supposed to drive. I mean, those lines are there just for reference. You know, they don't mean anything. But as I was making, and I actually said that, I don't want the dumb car telling me how I'm supposed to drive. It's going to cause me to wreck doing that thing. And as I was making that comment, I thought, man, that says a lot about the human heart right there. I don't want somebody telling me how I'm supposed to live. What do you mean when I start to get outside of the lines, you're going to auto-correct me? What do you mean when I start to drift away and veer off the course and I start to read that word and... You're telling me to get back in the lane. I got this. I know how to drive. I've been driving for almost 40 years. What do you mean telling me how to drive? Isn't that the mentality sometimes we get with the Lord? But his word is lane assisting us. It's getting us back on track. Look in 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. Famous passage on the scripture. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable, right? It's profitable. What's it profitable for? Doctrine, that's teaching. For reproof, that's the humbling part, I think, that we just talked about a moment ago. For lane correction. And for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So God's word teaches us what's right. It teaches us what's wrong. That's reproof. It corrects us when we need to be corrected, and it shows us, it instructs us on how to do the right thing. But sometimes we don't want to hear it because we don't want to be corrected. I'd rather do what I'm doing. But we need to be in God's word because it guides us in the way that we should go. It keeps us on course, moving in the right direction. So let's one last one. Back in Deuteronomy 17, verse 20, last part of verse 20. It says that he may prolong his days in his kingdom, he and his children, in the midst of Israel. So the final reason that the king was given the word of God was for prolonging. It says here that his adherence to the word of God, his handling of the word of God, was the key to establishing his kingdom and his reign being passed on from generation to generation to generation. If he wanted to stay in that position, if he wanted that kingdom to be passed on to his children after him for generation after generation, one of the things that he needed to do was abide by the word of God, the commandments of God. And you can see, again, we don't have time because I'm full of hot air to look at it all. But even if you back up a few verses from where we just were in Deuteronomy chapter 17, one of the things you're going to see that God tells the king that he wasn't to marry women outside of the nation of Israel. He wasn't supposed to do that. Wasn't to multiply to himself wives. You can see that in 17:17. Guess who did that? Solomon did that. Guess what happened? His heart was drawn away after strange gods. And so you can see the issues that the future kings had because they failed to adhere to the commandments of God. So what's the application for us? Because we're not kings of Israel that need to pass on our kingdom to the next generation. But I would say this. I think that one of the keys to a lasting and enduring walk with the Lord is your relationship and adherence to the Word of God. I think it's God's Word that enables us to run the race well and to finish the course He's given us to run. 2 Timothy 4:7, I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, I have kept the faith. What enabled Paul to do that? I think at least in part it was his relationship with God through the Word of God. Of course, he wrote portions of the Word of God under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. But I think one of the things that gives us, as believers in Christ, the ability to stay true to our faith, to continue to persevere and walk with the Lord, is our relationship with God's Word. We have to have that relationship with God's Word. And that's something that's de-emphasized, I think, in many instances in Christianity today. And as a result, I feel that we don't have as many people that are finishing their course. I could be wrong, but that's my opinion on that particular thing. And so God's Word is important. God's Word is so important to us. He's given it to us for a reason. And I hope, if nothing else, this little brief lesson from Deuteronomy 17 will serve to help us to, as we do the Bible Project this summer, to come with a heart that says, hey, you know what? We're keeping the commandments of God here. We're helping others to have a copy of the Word of God who may not have it. And as a result of us doing that, we're being a blessing to them and helping them to have something they can read and learn about God from and keep and do, and that will humble them and guide them and prolong their walk. That's the mindset I hope we come with this summer as we do our Bible Project. So we're way long, even longer than I normally am. So let's do this. I'm just going to pray for us. I did give you some discussion things you can think about, and a few prayer requests that you can lift up this week on your own. But let me pray for us as a group, and then we'll be finished for the evening. Let's pray. Father, we are thankful for the Lord Jesus. We are thankful for the Word of God. Lord, you are a gracious, blessed God who provides what we need, not the least of which is your Word. We are so thankful. Lord, we want to pause and thank you for the men and women who gave their lives so that we could have a copy of the Word of God that we can read and can be ours. Lord, I pray that we wouldn't be a generation that takes that for granted, but that we would take what we've been blessed with and then try and be a blessing to others in the same way. Lord, I pray that our daily interaction with your Word would be blessed, that we would read and learn, that we would endeavor to keep, that we would live out our faith in a big way, that we would let it guide us and correct us, and that it would give us the strength that we need to finish our course and run well. Lord, so often in our lives, if we're honest, we would admit that we're guilty of taking your word for granted. And we're sorry for that. And we ask that you would help us to grow in our appreciation and love for your word, and that we would learn to fear you, stand in awe and reverence of you. Lord, as we begin the Bible Project in a few weeks, I pray that it would be a blessed time. I pray that the fellowship we experience as we put our hands on your word would be sweet. And Lord, I pray most of all that you would take the scriptures that we're going to be assembling, that you would get them to the Philippines, and they could make their way into the hands of men and women that need to know you or want to know you more. Lord, I pray your word would be a blessing to them. Lord, we most likely will never meet or hear from any of the people that receive those scriptures. But Lord, we know in eternity, man, we're going to have a blowout party just celebrating our connection with one another through your word. And so I pray this summer that you would help us to come with that mindset of just wanting to be a blessing to men and women all over the world that need a copy of your word. Lord, we love you and we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.